Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Escape Artists, a band of daredevil pilots and the greatest prison break of the Great War, by Neal Bascomb, narrated by L.J. Ganser. To Liz and Susan, my editors par excellence. From an inscription on Holzminden cell wall from Richard Lovelace poem to Althea from prison. Stone walls do not a prison make, nor iron bars a cage. From A.J. Evans, inveterate World War I breakout artist. It seems to me that we owed it to our self-respect and to our position as British officers to attempt to escape, and to go on attempting to escape, in spite of all hardships. Dramatis personae. Key Holzminden escape artists. Captain David Gray, father of the tunnel. Royal Flying Corps, RFC pilot. Second Lieutenant Cecil Blaine, RFC pilot. Second Lieutenant Casper Kennard, RFC pilot. Lieutenant Colonel Charles Rathbone, senior British officer, Royal Naval Air Service, RNAS, wing commander. Sub-Lieutenant Leonard James Bennett, RNAS observer. Other Holzminden prisoners. Second Lieutenant Frederick William Harvey, the poet, Gloucestershire Regiment. Lieutenant William Shorty Cahoon, Princess Patricia's Canadian Light Infantry, originator of the tunnel. Second Lieutenant William Ellis, RFC pilot, originator of the tunnel. Captain Joseph Rogers, member of the Pink Toes, Durham Light Infantry. Captain Frank Mossy Moisey, member of the Pink Toes, Suffolk Regiment. Private John Dick Cash, camp orderly, Australian Imperial Force. Lieutenant Harold Medlicott, RFC pilot. Captain Hugh Durnford, adjutant to Rathbone, Royal Field Artillery. Second Lieutenant William Leif Robinson, Zeppelin killer, RFC pilot. Captain Douglas Grant, London Scottish Regiment. German officers. General Karl von Hainisch, head of the 10th Army Corps Division. Karl Milwaukee Bill Niemeyer, Stroen and Holzminden Commandant. Heinrich Windy Dick Niemeyer, Klausthal Camp Officer. Commandant Blankenstein, Osnabrück Camp. Commandant Gruben, Gütersloh Camp. Commandant Kurt, Krefeld Camp. Commandant Dietz, Schwarmstedt Camp. Commandant Wolf, Klausthal Camp. Prologue. July 14th, 1941. For all his wife, Elsie, and two young children knew, Jim Bennett was leaving for an overnight business trip. As he was the eponymous owner of a small import-export business that traded in China, couture clothes, and other fine goods, they expected such absences, even during wartime. Perhaps especially during wartime, no effort could be spared in keeping the bottom line from seeping red. Dressed in a light gray tailored suit with a white linen handkerchief in his pocket, he bid his family goodbye and walked out the front door of his five-bedroom brick house in Northwood, a bucolic neighborhood threaded with golf courses 15 miles northwest of London. The son of a farmer, Bennett had come a long way from the rolling fields of Somerset. Carrying a brown leather suitcase, heavier than one might imagine he would need for an overnight, Bennett joined the others, heading down Kew Ferry Road at morning rush hour to the Metropolitan Line London Underground Station. Few could keep to his normal brisk pace, even with the skies threatening a thunderstorm. At 49, and with thinning salt-and-pepper hair, Bennett remained trim and fit. On the half-hour ride into the city, there was plenty of time to page through the Daily Express. Its headlines read, Moscow denies claims by Berlin, and Nazis flee from Syria. Most interesting to Bennett was the story about the British air raid on Bremen, Germany. On the 32nd straight night of attacks into Germany, Bombers had struck the city's shipbuilding yards and factories. Two British planes had not returned to base. The fate of their crews, unknown. With the number of these raids accelerating every month, and more airmen shot down, Bennett knew that his particular expertise was in very high demand. He switched lines at Baker Street and arrived soon after at Paddington Railway Station, not far from his offices. 3 months before, the station had suffered a direct hit by German bombers that demolished the southwest corner and killed 18 people. In quick order, the rubble was hauled away from the tracks and train service resumed. Still, the piles of bricks and hollowed-out windows bore witness to the destruction that could rain down on London at any moment. Bennett boarded the 10:30 Great Western to Penryn, Cornwall, and settled into the second-class carriage for the five-hour journey. His firm had no business on the southwestern tip of England, nor was he traveling there for its sandy beaches, now fortified with pillboxes, minefields, and barbed wire enclosures, against the threat of a German attack. Instead, he was headed to the Royal Air Force Base at Predanik to lecture fighter squadron pilots on what to do if they found themselves captured or on the run in enemy-occupied territory. In his suitcase was an optoscope projector that looked like a small cannon, a number of slides, purses of foreign currency, silk maps, and compasses hidden in button studs. Earlier that morning, before his family awoke, he had taken these items out of the locked chest of drawers he kept in the house. While running his import-export business, Bennett also worked for MI9, a top-secret organization within British military intelligence. Recruited immediately after its founding, he was sworn to secrecy, forbidden from revealing his involvement even to family or friends. MI9 had been started in 1939 under the leadership of Major Norman Crockett, a medaled veteran of the Royal Scots and former stockbroker. Its purpose was to codify and teach principles of evasion and escape for the use of Allied soldiers, airmen, and naval personnel caught behind enemy lines. Crockett did not draw these principles from boys' own fiction or mothballed old tales, although there were stories aplenty of dramatic breakouts in the history of war and strife. Empress Matilda escaped from Oxford Castle in 1142, avoiding her pursuers by hiding in the snow under a white sheet. In 1621, the Dutch jurist Hugo Grotius was smuggled out of Liechtenstein Castle, where he was being held prisoner, in a book chest. In 1870, during the Franco-Prussian War, the French statesman Léon Gambetta rose up and away from a besieged Paris in a hot air balloon. Winston Churchill himself escaped from a Boer prisoner of war camp in South Africa by jumping over a fence and making off. These true stories were sedate compared with the adventures of the literary Count of Monte Cristo, to say nothing of Odysseus's supernatural deliverance out of Calypso's grotto. For MI9, however, Crockett called upon the lessons learned from the first-hand experiences of those who had escaped the Germans in World War I. And one of the participants in the greatest, the most successful breakout of that war, was Jim Bennett. Late in the afternoon, Bennett arrived at Redruth Station, where he was met by an RAF driver who whisked him southward to the newly built Predanik airfield near Mullion. On the apron of grass stood a line of Hawker Hurricanes and Bristol Bow Fighters. They were a sight more advanced than the wood, linen, and wire-strung contraptions in which Bennett used to hunt U-boats as a Royal Naval Air Service sub-lieutenant. At 8:45 p.m., his slide projector at the ready, Bennett stood at the head of a crowded hall. In his hand, he held a sheet of paper roughly torn from a notebook, upon which he had scrawled his lecture notes in bullet points. Addressing the assembled airmen, he spoke of the possibility of their being taken prisoner by the enemy and stressed that if captured, they had a duty to escape. Britain needed them back in its ranks. An escape attempt would also divert the attention of the Nazis, requiring the allocation of men and resources that might otherwise be used on the front line against Britain and its allies. Bennett added that if captured, the men's best opportunity to flee was the earliest opportunity, either while in a makeshift detention spot or during transport to a POW camp. Once arrived, their chances of breaking out diminished precipitously. Yet, even suffering extreme mental and physical stress, Bennett stated, they were to remember that their war effort was by no means over. He went on to detail escape routes from Germany and to explain how to create a simple code for secret messages. He stressed the need to stay fit during captivity and the importance of having a compass in order to reach the border. All of these lessons he framed within the context of his own story of crash landing into the sea in 1917, 15 miles from Zeebrugge, the Belgian port controlled at that time by the Germans. After he and the plane's pilot had drifted in the downed craft for almost an hour, a U-boat surfaced beneath them, and its crew seized the two men. Bennett illustrated his account with slides showing his aircraft, the camps in which he had been imprisoned, coded letters and tools used in various escape attempts. He spoke about Holzminden, the most notorious POW camp of the Great War, and the tunnel he and his fellow inmates had dug to escape its walls, how, over months, they had scraped away dirt, clay, and stone to burrow an underground passageway, inch by inch. He chronicled their preparations for the treacherous 150-mile journey through Germany to reach the Dutch border, how they had smuggled in supplies and hidden them in fake ceiling beams. Although Bennett had delivered this lecture many times, his voice still conveyed the range of emotion he had experienced during the breakout from Holzminden. No doubt his audience was riveted as he described the events of that night. The thrill of the call to go, the first moments moving into the tunnel on his belly, clawing his way forward in the darkness, without enough space overhead even to raise himself up on his forearms, the stalled advance, the rats scampering over his arms and legs, the muffled grunts and panicked breaths of the men in front of him and those behind, the straps of his escape kit getting caught on a rock, the hour it took to travel a distance he could have walked in a minute, the tunnel roof that was slowly collapsing on top of him, threatening to entomb him and all those who remained, the terror of possibly facing a rifle when he surfaced at last. The sense of responsibility Bennett felt made his retelling all the more visceral and electric. The young men gathered before him were running defensive patrols against German raiders and participating in offensive sweeps over France. There was a good chance that some of them would soon find themselves behind enemy lines, held as POWs or on the run. Given the Nazi reputation for torturing and sometimes hanging captured airmen, Bennett knew that his story, the story of the leaders of the 1918 Holzminden breakout, might well save the life of a pilot in that hall. Part 1. Capture. Chapter 1. The sky lightened from gray to pink as the No. 70 squadron of the Royal Flying Corps prepared to take off from its base. Already the din of shelling sounded in the distance. It was August 7th, 1916, at Fienvillers, 20 miles from the Somme battlefront. "Contact, sir," called the mechanic, his hand on the black walnut propeller of a Sopwith 1.5 strutter biplane. "Contact," answered its pilot, Cecil Blaine, from the fore cockpit, pushing the throttle open halfway, allowing fuel to rush into the 9-cylinder rotary engine. The mechanic jerked the propeller downward counterclockwise. With a belch of blue smoke, the Sopwith sputtered to life, the rush of air from the spinning propeller flattening the grass on the airfield behind the tailplane. As the engine warmed, its castor oil lubricant filled the air with the odor of burned almonds, nearly overwhelming Blaine and his observer, Charles Griffiths. Seated in the aft cockpit, the observer's role was critical. His various tasks included radio communication, aerial reconnaissance, and manning the guns. Once they finished their flight checks, Blaine waved his arm fore and aft, and the mechanic yanked out the wooden chocks, securing the biplane's wheels in place. All of 19 years of age, the youngest pilot in his squadron, Blaine might well have stepped straight off a Hollywood silent movie screen. With his square shoulders, handsome boyish face, sweep of ruffled blonde hair, and the perennial glint in his eye, he was well suited for the part of troublesome rascal. In the cockpit that morning, he looked like he might have been playing the role of Arctic explorer. Over a woolen pullover and a double set of underclothes, he sported a heavy leather jacket with fur-lined collar. He wore heavy boots and thick gloves. His neck was sheathed in a white silk scarf, and his face was slathered with whale oil and covered by a balaclava and goggles. He would need all that protection to withstand the blistering cold at 10,000 feet. After his squadron commander's plane took off, Blaine moved his Sopwith onto the runway. Following a quick look over his shoulder to check that Griffiths was ready, he directed the biplane forward. Its red, white, and blue roundels stood in sharp relief to the mud-green fuselage. Throttle full open now, engine buzzing, the Sopwith picked up momentum. Blaine fought against the crosswinds, buffeting the wings, and the inclination of the biplane's nose to lift up too early. Of the many accidents these rudimentary machines suffered, takeoffs accounted for almost half. Finally, at flying speed, Blaine pulled back the control stick and the Sopwith's wheels lifted gently free from the ground. Banking eastward, they soon left behind their tented camp, in an orchard next to the aerodrome. Then the bundle of 30 ramshackle cottages and the simple church that constituted Fianvillers. Once assembled in a V formation, the five Sopwiths set off eastward, the sky emblazoned bright orange ahead. Their mission was reconnaissance of Maubeuge, deep behind German enemy lines, to locate some munitions factories and an airship base housing Zeppelins. For a limited spell, Blaine and Griffiths could enjoy the thrill of soaring through the open air. The horizons stretched out in every direction. Mist clung to the low hollows of the hills, and chimney smoke rose from the surrounding villages. Compared to their maps, main roads clearly delineated in red, railways in black, forests in green, the French countryside was an endless patchwork of colored fields, threaded with gray lines and shadowed by clouds. In such a setting, pilots often found themselves as bewildered as a hiker in a dense forest, wandering in circles trying to find a landmark. But as they approached the trenches of the Western Front, there was no mistaking their position. It looks from the air as if the gods had made a gigantic steamroller 40 miles wide and run it from the coast to Switzerland, leaving its spike holes behind as it went, wrote one airman of the field of battle. Another described it thus: open for us to inspect were all the secrets of this waste of tortured soil, a barrier along which millions of armed men crouched in foul trenches. Below us lay displayed the zigzagging entrenchments, the wriggling communications to the rear, the untidy belts of rusty wire. Few accounts told of the innumerable dead soldiers rotting in no man's land, but they would have been visible to pilots that passed over the cratered chalk soil. On July 1st, 1916, shortly after Blaine arrived in France, 17 Allied divisions had begun a massive offensive to break through German lines on the upper reaches of the River Somme. At 0 hour, 7:30 a.m., to the sound of whistles blowing, lines of khaki-clad British soldiers and their blue-gray uniformed French counterparts rose from their trenches and attacked the Germans through no man's land under the withering chatter of machine gun fire. On the offensive's first day, the Allies took but a bite out of the enemy's ruined line, at the cost of almost 20,000 British dead and double that figure in wounded, the greatest loss of life in a single day in the country's military history. In the weeks that followed, wave after wave of attack and counterattack resettled the lines largely to where they had started. while continuing to attempt to wear down the enemy with small offensives, the British and French prepared for their next major move. For the No. 70 Squadron, there had been no pause from the unrelenting schedule of patrols and reconnaissance missions. Just the day before, Blaine had helped thwart a run by 10 German bombers over Allied trenches, harassing them in the sky until they retreated. As the five Sopwiths traveled across no man's land, the sky went thick with sudden coughs of black smoke. Before the smell of cordite stung their noses, the same thought ran through the whole patrol. Archie, innocuously nicknamed by pilots after a popular London music hall song whose refrain went, "Archibald, certainly not." These shells delivered death in many ways. A direct hit would crumple a plane in an instant, sending it in a precipitous drop from the sky, like a bird downed by a shotgun. The explosion alone could hurl a plane into an irrecoverable spiral, and Archie shells could kill an entire aircrew with a 360-degree spray of shrapnel that tore through flesh and the fragile structures that kept the planes aloft. On the port side of their formation, a shell rocked one Sopwith, but its pilot recovered. Another cut confetti-sized slits into the wings of Blaine's biplane, and shrapnel pinged against his engine cowling. As the woofed, woofed, woofed of Archie's pounded in their ears, Blaine inspected his controls. Everything looked okay. He glanced back at Griffiths, and they exchanged a thumbs up. As quickly as the barrage began, it ended. Onward they flew, toward Maubeuge, to continue their reconnaissance. Now that they were beyond enemy lines, Blaine knew that German fighters were likely to attack their formation, and he noted that there was little cloud cover in which to hide. Griffiths readied himself at his mounted Lewis machine gun, and they both searched the sky. Seconds later, their flight leader wiggled his wings, a warning signal. In the far distance, Blaine saw a colorless dot framed by the sun. The British formation remained tight, waiting to see if this speck in the sky would take the shape of a German patrol airplane. Nerves tight, prepared to separate from the formation for an aerial fight, Blaine waited. He soon picked out the black crosses of a lone two-seater German reconnaissance plane. Some pilots likened the sensation of first seeing the enemy to plunging into a cold bath. One aggressive move from it, and the Sopwiths would engage. Instead, the enemy plane swept past them in a straight westward line, no doubt on a scouting mission of its own in Allied territory. The Sopwiths continued east, no other planes in sight. The Germans might well wait to ambush their formation on its return toward Fionvillers. The airmen would be tired, dulled by the bitter cold, short on fuel, and slowed by the almost constant west wind that blew across northern France. 60 miles behind enemy lines, they sighted the glint of sun off the river Sambre and reached Maubeuge. The ancient city had been besieged and sacked many times over the centuries, handed between French, Spanish, and Austrian dukes and counts almost too many times to count. Yet it had never suffered the kind of heavy artillery bombardment unleashed by the Germans in their advance toward Paris in August 1914. When Blaine descended toward Maubeuge, he saw that its fortress walls were spilled piles of rubble. The Sopwiths broke away from one another to begin their reconnaissance. Cutting over the city, Blaine and Griffiths looked for the airship base marked on their maps. They passed the train station, the puffs of steam from a departing locomotive rising into the air. Up ahead, the mammoth gray sheds were easy to spot. On his first pass, Blaine saw nothing of note, but the Zeppelins could well be inside. He banked around and descended low for a second look. Approaching the sheds again, he eased back on the throttle. In that moment, a spout of blue flame burst from the Sopwith's rotary engine. Determining that one of the intake valves might be jammed, Blaine increased throttle again. More flames flashed out of the engine. As he tried to regain altitude, the engine's rhythmic, continuous drone became an irregular stutter. The Sopwith began to vibrate around him. A glance at the revolutions per minute counter confirmed the fear that had already shot through him. Engine trouble. The best he could hope for now was to get his plane out of enemy-occupied territory. There was a chance. He turned westward. One cylinder was definitely cutting out. Any attempt to alter the carburetor mix or clear the stuck valve failed. Blaine pushed to maintain altitude. The acrid stench of hot metal filled the air, and the Sopwith bobbed slightly up and down in the airstream as it slowed. Blaine continued to woo some effort from the engine, mile after precious mile. Then, with a frightening shriek, a piece of metal ripped through the engine cowling and flung off into the air behind him. Flames flared from the broken intake valve, and all of a sudden, the propeller stopped dead. Its violent arrest rattled the Sopwith. Blaine feared the whole engine might come loose. When its bearings held, he finally faced the realization that they remained far from home. They were going down. The best he could do now was get himself and Griffiths onto the ground alive. When Orville Wright performed the first flight in a powered airplane on December 17, 1903, he declared it to be the introduction into the world of an invention which would make further wars practically impossible. Hyperbole aside, Wright was correct that airplanes would bring a revolution in war, but not in the way he imagined. Instead of an instrument for peace, the airplane became a multi-pronged weapon in a conflict that would envelop the world. The British military establishment was slow to this realization. In 1910, the chief of the Imperial General Staff, Sir William Nicholson, regarded aviation as a useless and expensive fad advocated by a few individuals whose ideas are unworthy of attention. The first Sea Lord, Sir Arthur Wilson, followed up by stating that the naval requirement for aircraft was 2. Nonetheless, given developments in aviation, popular fascination with cross-channel flights, and the rise of air forces on the European continent, the Royal Flying Corps was founded in April 1912. Many remained unconvinced, including Douglas Haig, future commander-in-chief of the British Expeditionary Force. 4 weeks before Kaiser Wilhelm II sent German troops into Belgium, Haig declared to a roomful of generals, "I hope none of you is so foolish as to think that aeroplanes will be able to be usefully employed for reconnaissance in the air. There is only one way for a commander to get information, and that is by the use of cavalry." With such lack of support, the new branch of the British Army entered the war, a fledgling force staffed mostly by enterprising, well-heeled amateurs. The aircraft they brought to France were made from wood, wire, and canvas. They had only 70 horsepower engines, sped barely over 75 miles per hour, and took almost an hour to climb to their ceiling height of 10,000 feet. Pilots carried rifles for weapons and grenades for bombs. Soon after fighting began, however, many credited their bird's-eye role tracking troop movements with staving off the German envelopment of British troops and an early knockout blow in the war. A dispatch to London from the field commander praised the RFC's skill, energy, and perseverance. Beyond reconnaissance and artillery observation, squadrons started bombing German targets, tracking U-boats, battling the enemy for control of the skies, and defending the home front from Zeppelin and other attacks. An ever-widening war and increased duties demanded the RFC mint faster, more maneuverable, better armed, and more stable planes. Further, they needed to recruit thousands of pilots to fly them. By summer 1915, there were only 200 trainees at flying stations. The force did little to shake its preference for individuals of means, pedigree, and attendance at the best schools. Applicants abounded from Harrow and Eton, Oxford and Cambridge. After first asking why a potential candidate wanted to be a pilot, some interviewers followed with, "Do you ride?" The Director General of Military Aeronautics stated that, Flying is perhaps a little easier than riding a horse because you sit in a comfortable armchair in a quiet machine instead of a slippery saddle on a very lively horse. Candidates were also asked, what is your favorite amusement? Who is your favorite poet? Do you mind solitude? According to a journalist who reported on the selection process, Kipling or Stevenson was supposed to indicate greater promise than Shelley or Meredith. A football player stood better with the examiners than a pianist. It also did not hurt if applicants rode motorcycles. Fast. Notwithstanding the desire for gentleman pilots, Hugh Trenchard, the RFC's commander in France, looked for other characteristics as well. High spirits and resilience of youth. They should be under 25 and unmarried. Athletic, alert, cheerful, even happy-go-lucky. The paragon would also reveal initiative and a sense of humor. The greatest strength was an incurable optimism. In temperament and background, Cecil William Blaine fit the bill perfectly. Born in 1896, he was the eldest son of a wealthy cotton merchant in Bromborough, a village on the Wirral Peninsula south of Liverpool. His mother, Mary, was a descendant of Sir Joshua Reynolds, the painter and founder of the Royal Academy of Arts. Blaine attended the Loretto School, the Scottish institution that had churned out its share of famous bankers, politicians, judges, and clergymen. The boarding school was also known for its sporting prowess, and like his younger brother Harry, Cecil excelled at cricket, rugby, and golf. On graduation at 17 years of age, he did not join his classmates at university. Instead, he journeyed to South Africa, where his uncle owned a large ranch and pineapple farm. Rather than follow his father into business, he intended to be a farmer, where he could tend a field, ride horses, and spend his days in the sun. The outbreak of war foiled these free-spirited plans. Blaine felt compelled to return to fight for his country. With connections and letters of reference, he secured a spot in the RFC. Its glamour and gallant reputation made it an attractive service for most young men. To start his training, Blaine ran the gauntlet of School of Military Aeronautics lectures on everything but the practical aspects of flying. Then, in mid-December 1915, he traveled to Northolt Aerodrome outside London for flight school. Hours after his arrival, he was climbing into a Maurice Farman Longhorn biplane for his first spin in the air. He stepped carefully as he boarded, so as not to put his foot through the canvas wing. With a 50-foot span and powered by a V8 engine, the Longhorn looked as unsteady as the first plane flown by the Wright brothers. The whole contraption was held together with piano wire, one trainee described. Lift wires, landing wires, drift wires, bracing wires. We used to say you could safely cage a canary in a Longhorn without fear of losing it. For his maiden flight, sitting in the toe of the shoe-shaped cockpit with an instructor behind him, Blaine did not have command of the Longhorn's dual controls. His instructor simply wanted to see how he reacted to the flight, and if he lost his wits when the instructor staged a planned stall in midair. Blaine passed the test. Then he had a few lessons in the Longhorn, where he learned to fly the aircraft himself. He took off, performed left-hand and right-hand circuits, and landed, all the while suffering the shouts and kicks to the back of his seat from his instructor, who would take over the controls only if they were at the precipice of a crash. After two few hours of flying experience, he was charged with his first solo. Blaine was not following a set syllabus or instruction technique. Neither existed, nor were his instructors professionals. Most were simply RFC veterans on leave from the front, some washed out from trauma. At Northolt, crashes were frequent, often deadly. Of the roughly 9,000 men who died in the RFC over the course of the war, 1 in 4 was killed in training. Planes pancaked on rough landings or overshot the runway altogether, smashing into trees. Mid-air collisions occurred. Planes overturned and spiraled out of control. Engines died. Petrol ran out. Wings became untethered. Rudders stuck. pilot inexperience or mechanical failure, or both, delivered death equally. On a typical day of training, it was standard fare for a cadet to witness a dozen crashes. Often the wreckage was so grisly, the ambulance did not have to hurry. The flight school took up collections to pay for funerals, and trainees often found themselves serving as pallbearers. When Blaine took his first solo flight, pilots stood at the aerodrome perimeter, a last will and testament held aloft in their hands. The gallows humor was meant to cut through the tension, but Blaine would have to have been made of stone to be unafraid. In his memoir, Sagittarius Rising, World War I pilot Cecil Lewis best described the terrifying thoughts that sprinted through a cadet's head when first flying solo. At the takeoff, rudder, elevator, ailerons, God, who said they wanted to fly? She's lifting away, she's away. At mid-flight, try a right turn now. Now, oh, she's shuddering, there's something wrong. Straighten, quick, straighten. No, it's all right. At landing, throttle back and nose down together. Shall we get in? Yes, no, a bit more engine. That's it. You're flying into the ground. Pull her up, up, not too much. Bang, bounce, bounce, rumble. We're down. I've done it. I haven't crashed. Blaine survived his 15-minute solo. After a test flight on January 14, 1916, that included a pair of figure-eight turns, a climb to 900 feet, and a pinpoint landing with the engine cut off, he was issued his wings. Donning the double-breasted, high-collared uniform that pilots nicknamed the maternity jacket, Second Lieutenant Blaine had no more than a handful of hours in the air. Over the next 5 months, he continued training in England, a benefit many new pilots missed before shipping off for a squadron in France. At Northolt and reserve squadrons elsewhere, Blaine witnessed more crashes, more death, all the while growing to be a steady hand in Avros, Blériot, and Sopwiths. Although no pilot could avoid his share of surprise stalls or strut-smashing landings, Blaine proved himself a natural in the air. In June, the RFC assigned him to the newly formed No. 70 Squadron, responsible for long-range offensive patrols in enemy territory. He left for France in time for the launch of the Somme offensive. 8 weeks later, of the 36 original pilots and observers in his squadron, Blaine was one of only nine who remained. Some dropped out from nerves, others were severely wounded, and the rest had been killed or captured by the enemy. No use! Got to land! Blaine called back to Griffiths. Throw your gun overboard! With the propeller stopped and the altimeter reading 3,000 feet, they were going down. The lighter the plane, the more distance Blaine might be able to eke out of their glide. 5 miles was likely the maximum, far from the safety of Allied lines. At best, they had made it 24 miles from Maubeuge. As Griffiths tossed out drums of ammunition, then the Lewis gun, Blaine performed a delicate dance in the air. He alternated between leveling the nose of the plane and pointing it downward. Too much of the former, they would lose height quickly. Too much of the latter, they would stall, the wings not producing enough lift to keep the Sopwith in flight. He played by feel, by the sound of the biplane's wires moving through the air. Whenever the wires started to vibrate at a high pitch, he needed to pull back on the control stick and level out some. When they went almost quiet, he angled the nose down again. With the engine dead, the cockpit was unnervingly silent, but for the singing of the wires and the rushing wind. At last, there was nothing Blaine could do but land. They sailed over a French village, low enough to see its inhabitants looking up at them with incredulous faces. Blaine spied a level pasture dotted with cows, and he aimed to land on a path between the beasts. He set the plane gently down, and its wheels rumbled to a stop in the high grass. Alone, but for the cows, Blaine and Griffiths scrambled out of the plane. If they were able to fix the engine quickly enough, they could get themselves back in the air and out of harm's way. A quick inspection dashed their hopes. The crankcase was a shred of metal. One of the 9 cylinders of the rotary engine was loose, and its piston was crushed. Knowing full well they were stuck, Blaine and Griffiths set upon their plane, putting fists and feet through the wings. Of the few instructions their commanders gave them in the event they were shot down, the first was to destroy their machine, so the Germans could neither use it nor learn from its advances. In this new battlefield in the sky, every advantage in developing technology might prove the difference between defeat and victory. By this time, a crowd of women and young children had crossed the pasture toward them, shouting and gesturing frantically at the 2 Englishmen. Blaine understood them to be saying that they had landed near Caudry, far on the wrong side of the line. He smiled and shook their hands repeatedly. The Allies were winning the war, he reassured them. The women urged the 2 aviators to return into the sky. Les Boches arrivent, they said. Griffiths opened the fuel tank and soaked a cloth with some petrol. He then circled the biplane, smearing petrol across the wings, while Blaine moved the crowd away. Then he set the biplane on fire with his lighter. Flames ran across the fuselage and wings as the first German soldiers marched into the pasture, weapons drawn. The heat from the spreading inferno reached several bullet cartridges that Griffiths had not thrown out of the plane. The crack of exploding bullets stopped the advancing soldiers. Blaine and Griffiths kept their hands high in the air. The soldiers started forward again, one with an Alsatian dog on a leash. They were almost upon the 2 airmen when the petrol tank burst. The shock sent the Alsatian dashing away in fright, its handler sprinting across the uneven field after him. For a moment, as the villagers laughed at the absurd scene, Blaine could push away the crushing truth that he was about to become a prisoner of war. The patrol seized the 2 Englishmen and marched them into Caudry. Blaine, who during his time in South Africa had learned Cape Dutch, similar to German, was able to decipher some of the soldiers' orders. The town did not have a jail, so they were held in its post office. An hour later, a German officer named Röder, who spoke English, arrived on the scene. He had the 2 searched and took away some personal letters and money in their possession. Blaine managed to hide his silver cigarette lighter. Then Röder and a guard took them away in his car. On the road to Cambrai, they passed columns of worn-out soldiers, followed by a line of horse transports. The old French fortress town stood on a slight hill, its stone ramparts stretching 50 feet high. Guards stopped the car at the edge of the old moat. Röder barked at them and was allowed to pass across the drawbridge and under the massive archway of the fortress. Blaine and Griffiths were directed into a sliver of a cell. The stifling heat hit them first, then the foul smell. 2 straw mattresses covered what little floor there was. When they tried to sleep, they found their threadbare, soiled blankets alive with lice. In the morning, a guard brought them some square hunks of sour black bread, their first meal in 24 hours. Lunch and dinner was cabbage soup that resembled filthy bathwater. It was served in slop pails. When briefly let out of their cell, they found the citadel crowded with other prisoners and plagued by dysentery. Blaine saw a wounded soldier lying on the stone floor, his upper arm a fetid gob of open flesh, dried blood, dirt, and straw. Guards forbid anyone from helping him. The cruelty made Blaine seethe. Night after night, the airman lay on his mattress, too troubled to sleep. Thoughts of escape crept around the edges of his consciousness, but the shock of his capture overwhelmed him. Chapter 2. Early on August 17, 1916, under the red glow of a falling flare, Second Lieutenant Will Harvey made his way through the frontline trench. The narrow passages were sunk a few feet into the earth, then built up with sandbag walls that rose high over his head, resembling crenellated battlements. Duckboards covered the trench floor, but the slick planks were not enough to prevent his boots sinking into the river of mud beneath as he pushed through the mass of soldiers who inhabited this bleak underworld. Those on sentry duty stood up on the fire step, rifles in hand, peering into the dark for any hint of a German advance. Others worked to shore up crumbling walls, hauled supplies, rebuilt parapets destroyed by shelling. Some clambered back down into the trench after fixing a patch of barbed wire in no man's land. Those who were off duty huddled along the passageways, smoking cigarettes, brewing tea on charcoal braziers, or trying to catch a couple of hours of restless sleep amid a scurry of rats. Harvey continued through the trench, checking on his platoon in the 5th Battalion, Gloucestershire Regiment. He did not look like the typical decorated officer. "I never saw anyone less like a hero in my life," one soldier wrote. "Imagine a small, dirty, nearly middle-aged man, wearing glasses and an apologetic air, trudging along the pavé under a huge pack. He looks as if he stuffed birds in civil life." At 28 years of age, Harvey was hardly middle-aged, but his short, sturdy frame and soft, round face made him easily forgettable. Few have better proved that a book is best not judged by its cover. Only the day before, his battalion had moved into the Fauquisard sector. Near the village of Neuve-Chapelle, site of a fierce onslaught by the British across 2,000 yards of no man's land in March 1915, the area was now in a state of relative calm. They were far north of the Somme, the latest fixation of the Allies in their attempt to break the stalemate of the Western Front. Before dawn came the chilling call of, "Stand to!" Soldiers scrambled to take their positions along the parapet wall with fixed bayonets, knowing well that the rising sun often brought an enemy attack. In the silence that followed, Harvey and his men stared across the tangled hedges of barbed wire for any sign of movement. Minute after minute passed, but the only assault came from the swarms of fetid, blue-bellied flies that thrived in the summer heat and flesh of the dead. An hour later, "Stand down," passed through the line, and drams of rum were given out. The morning looked to be the usual start of another day in the trenches. Harvey tried to get some rest in a dugout, but he could not shake loose his thoughts about the patrol he was tasked to lead that evening. He had more experience, and success, with such dangerous missions than anyone in his battalion, but this did not ease his mind. The British command wanted to ensure that the Germans did not divert resources from other areas to the Somme, and ordered sporadic raids up and down the line to keep them on edge. For the upcoming raid by Harvey's battalion, a reconnaissance of the German trenches was considered necessary. The more Harvey thought about it, the more determined he was to check out the terrain himself before venturing out with his men. This action might well save one of their lives. Once he had resolved to go out alone first, Harvey was able to shut his eyes and sleep for a couple of hours. Later that morning, he searched out his friend from home, Ivor Gurney. Although they were in the same regiment, they rarely saw one another, given the shifting schedules of the trench. The two shared a love for poetry, music, and books. Harvey gave Gurney his pocket edition of The Spirit of Man by Robert Bridges, and they spent a few moments in conversation about Britain's poet laureate, whose latest work urged his fellow countrymen to face the intolerable grief of war by training their minds to interpret the world according to their higher nature. In the early afternoon, Harvey sent word of his proposed scouting mission to his company officer, then alerted the British sentries about the same to avoid being killed by friendly fire. At 2 p.m., he readied to go, a mud-stained copy of Shakespeare's sonnets in his pocket, as always. A sentry pulled aside the sally port in the parapet wall. Mouth dry from nerves, Harvey climbed through it. As the soldier returned the defense into place, Harvey wriggled across a stretch of tall grass that had somehow avoided being burned or destroyed by shelling. 300 yards away stood the German lines. The next few hours were typically the part of the day when both sides rested before the long pitch of night. Few were on duty apart from the sentries, and even they were not at their keenest. Harvey hoped to reconnoiter a forward sap, a span of trench that ran out perpendicular from the enemy's front line that was used as an observation post. He believed the sap was lightly defended, or altogether unoccupied. If it was, it might serve as a point of attack in the upcoming raid. An unsteady wind blew, rustling the tall grass, camouflaging Harvey as he moved forward on his stomach. When he came upon twists of barbed wire, he either crawled over them or brushed them aside with the wooden bludgeon he always carried on such patrols. At times he was hidden in shell holes or in the shadow of a short hedge that ran through this former farmland. Other times he was all but exposed if he lifted up too high on his forearms. Every move risked detection. If his equipment rattled, if he knocked into an unseen tin can or other piece of litter, he was lost. Although he held his bludgeon in one hand and an automatic pistol in the other, he knew that neither would serve much purpose if a German sniper spotted him. All the way forward, he made note of where the barbed wire was thickest, as well as any shell holes that might serve as temporary shelters from machine gun fire. He crawled down into a drain that ran toward the German parapet. Very close now. At this point, if he had been there with others, he would have turned back. Alone, confident in his ability, he inched onward until he reached the front line trench. Resting in the shadow cast by the stacked sandbags, he held his breath and trained his ears for any sound beyond. A cough, a whisper of conversation, a footfall, a cleared throat, a rifle stock shifted into place. There was nothing. Lifting his head slightly, he peered left and right along the parapet, searching for a spying German periscope or the top of a head. Nothing. After a few seconds, he rose slowly onto the parapet, then popped up to look down into the trench. It was empty. There was no doubt he should return to his own line. He had scouted a path through no man's land and had found a potential access point for the raid on the German trenches. Although his objective was fulfilled, he wanted to explore further to see how much of this section was undefended. Every yard of weakness in the line he could scout would save many lives. He'd already come this far. "Be damned if I go back," Harvey muttered to himself. He heaved himself up and over the parapet wall into the trench. Unseen, he moved down the sap, toward the adjoining traverse, and peered down the path, finding it also to be empty. Creeping onward, pistol at the ready, he thought about hiding out in the German lines throughout the night to scout their mortar placements and machine gun nests. If he found an exit gap in the back wall of their trenches, he could lie in the grass until early morning. With this idea in mind, he searched for such a gap, but found none. Reaching the next turn in the line, he heard from behind him the sound of advancing soldiers. There was no going back. He continued on ahead, glancing left and right, urgently needing an exit now. The walls were uniform, tall, and without a break. On the next traverse, he turned the corner to discover a dugout braced with iron, a mortar shelter. He could hide there until whoever was coming from behind had passed. Rushing toward the doorway, he was suddenly confronted by two German soldiers on their way out. In his shock, Harvey did not have time to raise his pistol. The two men seized the poet soldier of Gloucestershire with little trouble. When earth was a chalice of wonder, not malice, and time but a palace built for a boy. So had written Frederick William Harvey from the trenches in a poem about his childhood home, the Redlands. Constructed by his father, a farmer and horse breeder, the Georgian house sat amid gardens, orchards, and water meadows on the banks of the River Severn. The eldest of five, Will enjoyed a happy middle-class childhood, mucking about in the duck pond, riding ponies in the surrounding countryside, and sporting against other kids in nearby Minsterworth village, west of the city of Gloucester. While their father tirelessly worked the farm and bred shire horses, their mother was the gentle but firm hand that ran the household. Laughter and love surrounded the Harvey dinner table at night. Within the bounds of this normal, pleasant life, Will stood apart from his siblings. He was almost a head shorter than his younger brothers and shared none of their stark good looks. Although he liked the rough and tumble of cricket and hockey, he was equally content reading a book. At 7, he could recite by heart whole poems by Shelley and Browning, and he loved to sing. Prone to mood swings, he was never quite at peace within himself. He was also cavalier about risk, whether handling unbroken horses or engaging in a rugby scrum. He measured danger with a different yardstick than others did. As the eldest, Will carried the greatest weight of his parents' expectations. Good school, proper job, proper life. After his 18th birthday in 1906, he began the study of law in Gloucester at the urging of his mother. He found the subject dry and soulless. While in the city, he befriended Ivor Gurney and a host of others whose passion was the arts rather than the rule of law. Harvey began writing lines of verse and despaired that he was not being true to the real me. His father's unexpected death, then the failure to pass his law examinations after 4 years of study, only heightened this feeling that he was being caged into a life he did not want. The same rumbling against convention roiled all of Britain at that time. Queen Victoria died in 1901. After almost 64 years on the throne, espousing throughout her reign the virtues of order, class, duty, and empire. Her death unmoored the country, and her son and successor, Edward VII, ushered in a new age while putting a much lighter hand on the helm. Those insulated from change, or blind to it, looked forward to the first decade of the 20th century as a languid stroll through a comfortable afternoon. The economy was stable, incomes and trade were up, and there was peace between most nations. Regardless, the modern age was steaming into the station, with all its possibilities and pitfalls. Workers unionized, women demanded the right to vote, parents clamored for better schools for their children, and the poor for opportunities for a better life. In the House of Commons, upstart politicians promised that they better represented the people's will than the blue bloods of the House of Lords. The Irish raised to a fever pitch the right to home rule. Playwrights like Bernard Shaw fought to stage stories of life as it was, not as moralist Victorian censors wanted it to be. Novelists and poets published works with the same intent. The church fell exposed to advances in science and technology. The secrets of the atom revealed by Ernest Rutherford called into question the very nature of the world, while the invention of radio, the telegraph, motor cars, airplanes, and turbine-powered ships showed the power of humankind to bridge expanses once unimaginable. Despite these reverberations of change and his own unease, Harvey tried to remain dutiful to family and a stable career. After renewed study in London, he managed to pass the law exams and began working as a solicitor, writing business contracts, settling will disputes, and the like. Now, with a steady salary, he aimed to marry a young Irish nurse, Sarah Ann Kane, who went by her middle name, whom he had met during a short stay in hospital for a minor infection. Everything was falling into place as it should in terms of familial expectations, yet Harvey longed to devote himself to poetry. One afternoon in 1914, bored with the law, believing he was helping industry at the expense of the worker, Harvey walked away from his solicitor's job. He returned to the Redlands, hopeless and unsure of his future in every way but for his love of Anne. Then on June 28th, Serbian nationalists assassinated Austrian Archduke Franz Ferdinand in Sarajevo. Although the death of the heir to the Austro-Hungarian Empire may have lit the fuse of war, any number of acts could have stamped it out before the explosion. But hapless diplomats and the leaders they served failed to do so. Indeed, many never tried, giving in to the suggestions of battle-hungry generals. Hastening the disaster was an assembly of ossified empires, tangled alliances, inflexible war plans, massive standing armies, and the views of Germany, most prominently those of Kaiser Wilhelm II, that the country must choose world power or downfall. At its outset, the march to war looked often like a celebration. In capital cities throughout Europe, crowds poured into the streets, waving flags and singing national anthems. Tsar Nicholas stood on the balcony of the Winter Palace in St. Petersburg, and thousands kneeled to pay him homage. Kaiser Wilhelm appeared in field uniform and spoke to the German people of the sword.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.